The Corning Museum of Glass and WENY present New Space, New Light. Exploring the contemporary art and design wing at the Corning Museum of Glass.
Hello, and welcome to New Space, New Light, exploring the contemporary art and design wing at the Corning Museum of Glass. I'm Renata Steele. We're giving you an in-depth look at a new era for the museum, helping tell the world the story of glass. Spring marks a changing of seasons, ushering in new light. Much like the contemporary art and design wing bathes works of glass in light from above. We're giving you an exclusive and in-depth view of the new wing, from its design, installation of artworks inside, and a rebirth of a space with deep glassmaking tradition. Let's take a look. And I'm joined here now by Carol White, who is the President and Executive Director of the Corning Museum of Glass. And Carol, I want to thank you so much for talking with me about the museum. And now we are going to visit the Contemporary Art and Design Wing in just a little bit. But first, this is not the first expansion that the Corning Museum of Glass has gone through.
Oh, by no means. When we opened in 1951, we had 2,000 objects and two people working here for the museum. So a lot has changed in the last 60 or so years. Mm-hmm. This is in fact our fourth expansion.
Oh, wow.
Because as our visitation and our collection has grown, so has the footprint of this museum.
And of course, the flood of 72 had the museum making some changes after that point and after the flood recovery as well, correct?
That is correct. In fact, where we're standing in my office is below the flood level of the 1972 flood, which tells you where the galleries were at that time. So the decision was made to engage Gunnar Burkerts to design a brand new gallery space for the collection, and that expansion opened in about 1982.
Okay, and now for this newest expansion, what was the process into deciding that it was necessary and then moving forward to where we are today?
Well, we're in the enviable position of constantly having growing visitation, and we're also very pleased to say that our visitors enjoy spending time here. So in order to accommodate the growing number of visitors and to give them a really wonderful environment in which to spend their time, we decided we needed to expand our footprint. It also was in response to the needs of our collection. Contemporary glass keeps getting bigger and bigger, and we really had no gallery space that was appropriate to house and display that collection.
And now moving forward, you've certainly got that space, and we're going to check it out. So when you walk into there at this point, how does it make you feel that this is the next generation for the Corning Museum of Glass?
I am thrilled. The space is beautiful. It is filled with light. People are going to see this amazing collection in a completely new and unique way, skylit from above. It just makes you feel wonderful to be in that gallery space.
All right, and that is where we're going to go. So let's go check out the Contemporary Art and Design Wing. Stay with us. And we are now in the Contemporary Art and Design Wing. And Carol, you had mentioned that this is the fourth expansion for the museum. Why was it important for the Corning Museum of Glass to expand once again?
Well, we really needed a space not only to accommodate the size of our contemporary collection. You can see a piece over my shoulder that hangs from the ceiling. We didn't have any gallery spaces in which we could display some of these works. So we needed a contemporary space for our contemporary collection. And we engaged Tom Pfeiffer in New York to design this fabulous gallery building for us to accommodate our collection. But in addition to the size of the collection, it was the fact that our visitation has doubled in the last 10 years, and we needed an expanded footprint to accommodate our visitors.
And now, why the focus on contemporary glass specifically?
Well, our galleries are laid out in a chronological order. So we start with the creation of glass in the second millennium BC, and our visitors go through all of our gallery spaces to the present day. Our collection was growing. We were running out of footprint in which to display the pieces, particularly the contemporary large pieces. And so we felt that we needed a gallery space that could accommodate this beautiful contemporary collection that we were building.
As people come to visit the new wing and they walk through the galleries and visit the new hot glass amphitheater, how are you hoping that this changes the way that they see and they experience glass?
Well, we know a lot of our visitors don't really know what to expect when they're coming to the Corning Museum of Glass. So we want to convey to them the full story of glass from today all the way into the past. Contemporary glass is usually the first thing our visitors encounter, and they are blown away with what artists have done with this material. So to have the proper environment in which to showcase this stunning collection was very important to us. And we also needed an expanded footprint in order to accommodate visitors who wanted to watch our hot glass demonstrations. Mm-hmm. So the amphitheater hot shop, which now seats 500, is the perfect place to see contemporary glass being made, not only by our gaffers who are doing daily demonstrations, but by the guest artists that we will be inviting to work into this brand new studio space.
And so when people visit, they may see some pieces that they have recognized from the museum before, but there's so much new stuff. And as you mentioned, the new hot glass hot shop is really going to change that experience for visitors as well.
Oh, it's incredibly compelling to be able to come into a museum and to see this material handled in front of your eyes, to see the artists or the gaffers creating a vessel in front of you, because it so informs your visit back into the gallery space. It gives you a glimpse into the artistic process.
All right, well, Carol, thank you very much. And we are going to do some exploring ourselves for this next half hour.
After more than 3 years in the making and $64 million, the new 100,000 square foot contemporary art and design wing has transformed from concept and into reality. The gallery features more than 100 glass objects, and this gallery is truly a match made in heaven for these large-scale works, because the gallery was designed to showcase glass in the best possible setting for museum visitors to enjoy and interact with.
It wasn't just about, here's a collection, let's find an interesting room for it. It was, let's tailor this space to that collection.
Adam Ruffin, the project architect, says the new wing of the Corning Museum of Glass puts each exhibit in a setting that even seasoned visitors have never experienced before.
You want to give someone a completely new appreciation of this collection. And I think that's what this is going to do. No one's ever seen art in a space like this. No one's ever seen this collection in a space like this.
The overall building design is rectangular and simple on the outside, but on the inside, you would be hard-pressed to find a 90-degree angle among the curved walls and the sleek room designs. During the daytime, the wing will have an outside feel, thanks to the unique ceiling design and massive windows to allow natural lighting in.
There's over 900 skylights in this space. That's an incredible amount of glass for any room, but it's almost more like an atrium than it is a museum. So the amount of daylight in this space all the year long is more than you'd ever expect. It feels like you're outside. In full spectrum color, you see every component of the glass. You see the kind of subtlety and nuance of the material. In handmade glass, there's a lot of sort of textural conditions that it's great to see in full light.
Inside of the galleries of the new wing, glass is, of course, showcased. But right next door, new glass is born. Born in an old building that got a breath of fresh air.
We were so happy to be able to make a space where the glass was going to be made right next to the place where a lot of glass was going to be shown.
What was once the Steuben Glass blowing room was renovated both inside and out, while leaving as much of the original building intact.
I knew as soon as we came here that that building had a long life and that it was a real important marker in the community. And so we wanted to try to respect it as much as possible.
Here, hundreds of people can watch glass as it transforms into works of art forged by heat at the hand of a gaffer. Adam says the whole project was not just about building and renovating, but instead creating a place to make new experiences.
It's going to be very new even for people who've been here hundreds of times. So I don't think anyone's used to this. The gaffers are really excited about the space. The curators here are very excited about the art. The last component there is whether the visitor has a great time being here. So we're going to be even more excited when we see a lot of happy faces in here.
From acquiring the artwork and arranging the displays, Tina Oldknow is the senior curator of modern and contemporary glass here at CMOG and has full control of the content and creative flow of the new wing. Aisha McKenzie talked with Oldknow about the artworks and what they symbolize.
Works inspired by the body, nature, and design. Each room tells a different story about contemporary glass, with pieces by many different artists working in glass today. And it's all the vision of Tina Oldknow.
The most exciting part for me is this, opening a new gallery or a new exhibition with work and just seeing the pleasure in people's faces when they get to experience it.
Corning Museum of Glass's new wing showcases nearly 120 objects, a quarter of which are on view for the very first time. Most objects are made by artists known for their work in glass, but some new installations were created by artists who dabble in the medium. Like artist Kiki Smith, who created this room display titled Constellation, the first ever room-size installation at the museum.
She works in many materials. Glass is just one of the materials she uses. But she chose to use glass in her evocation of the night sky.
In this work, you can see Cancer the Crab, Capricornus, Ursa Major and Minor, and so many other well-crafted animals.
She really focused on animals because she believes that without animals, we can't really know who we are.
And that brings us to this room in the new wing. Its purpose and focus is nature, with this piece that towers over all the others.
This is an installation called Forest Glass by Catherine Gray, and it's made up of over 2,000 drinking glasses.
This piece is a little different from all the others. The artist didn't make the glass, but bought them and arranged them strategically to depict three large trees.
The piece is called Forest Glass, which alludes to a kind of glass that was made during the Middle Ages, but it also alludes to the fact that for many, many centuries, forests, that is trees, were used for fuel, to fuel the glass furnaces.
And during that time, many trees were destroyed, and Catherine Gray wanted to give back in her own way.
And she asks herself as an artist, as a maker, what her responsibility is in using natural resources to make her work.
This piece by Catherine Gray showed what kept alive the growing and successful glass industry, but this piece symbolizes something much darker.
This is a sculpture called Corona, which means carrion, by the Spanish artist Javier Perez.
Ono says Perez was invited to Murano, a famous glassmaking island in Venice, to be an artist in residence.
And he wanted to make a piece about the crisis in Murano today, the real crisis in the industry where people really aren't going into the glass factories anymore and making the amazing things that they used to make. And in fact, the very craft of glass blowing is being lost.
The artist took a Venetian chandelier and completely smashed it.
And then put taxidermied crows on it, like they're eating carrion at the side of the road in a pool of blood. You know, that this is this very dramatic piece talking about this centuries-old tradition of glassmaking in Murano, which is in crisis and disappearing.
But no matter how dark the message of the past of glass or how bright the present and future of the art is, the natural light from above gives each piece its own life and story.
So we've seen a majority of the artworks being displayed here in the museum, but have you ever wondered how it gets here? Samantha Potter spoke with the collections and exhibitions manager on how fragile glass gets installed.
Well, it's a curator who decides what artwork comes into the museum. It's Warren Bunn's job to oversee that it's installed properly, and most importantly, to balance safety and aesthetics.
Glass is, again, fragile, so we don't want to damage the object. It's sharp and heavy, so we don't want to damage each other when we're installing. We want to think about the safety of our visitors.
And since this is a glass museum, we're not talking about hanging a picture on the wall, but actually putting the artwork together.
And this is an example where we had some good photographs of the object, but it didn't come with any instruction manual at all. We unpacked and cataloged all of the parts and pieces for the object, and then we worked with our curator and our installation team to sort of organize and plan out how we would best sort of maximize the drama of the piece.
And it's never just Warren. It takes a whole installation team to install the artwork, and in this case, help create. The team even went as far as researching crows eating roadkill to get a real-life dramatic effect for the piece. Often, that means collaborating with the artist.
There are occasions where the artist will come see it and say, oh, I really love this, or, you know, I was wondering, can we tweak it a little bit? And we typically try to work with, that's the great thing about working in contemporary art is that you have living artists to talk to, you have them to feel.
From when the pieces arrive in the fragile crate to seeing the final outcome, it certainly isn't a day project. Warren says some collections can take weeks to install. For example, this piece. Since it's supposed to look like the pieces are floating, the installation team had to build a metal structure to suspend from the ceiling just to hang each individual piece.
We worked very hard to have the architecture that sort of supports the piece blend in and live harmoniously with the architecture of the building, so that people aren't so focused on looking up and trying to figure out how it works, but more experiencing the glass down below.
Warren explains the natural light coming into the museum is a huge positive for the artists and the pieces they create. And since glass looks great with light, Corning is able to use natural light to its advantage.
The daylit galleries create a much different way to look at the objects, and we are somewhat more liberated in that we have many more objects that can tolerate light.
Warren says one of the coolest parts of the new exhibit is what's surrounding the artwork. The museum partnered with Corning Incorporated and is using Gorilla Glass as a barrier around the collections.
Part of the challenge is we need to think about the visual impact, but also we need to balance it with sort of security and you know, aesthetic and safety sort of get balanced in all of our installations.
Saying keeping the artwork safe is the number one priority.
And as you're walking through the galleries, looking at the artwork or admiring the architecture, you may find yourself wanting to learn more. Well, don't worry, there's an app for that.
Grab your smartphone, tablet, and headphones because you can take your gallery experience to a digital level with the museum's new free app, Glass App.
It's just as simple as connecting to the museum's free Wi-Fi, and then all of a sudden you have this multimedia experience in the new galleries where you can just get a wealth of information that will really enhance your visit.
And it's much more than your typical museum audio tour. As you walk around the gallery, if you get the urge to run to Google to learn more or get your questions answered, Glass App will be right there at your fingertips.
It's more for if you're inspired by something, you know, you can look it up by visually browsing or doing a search, and then do, you know, either just watch the little short video and get inspired, and then if you want to dig deeper, there's a lot more information on everything.
You can find everything from information about the pieces to artist biographies, interviews, pictures, tons of video segments, even information on different events happening throughout the whole museum.
So if you're interested in catching a hot glass demo in our new amphitheater or in the innovation stage, you're going to be able to look at Glass App, and it's going to have up to the minute information as to like when the next show is happening.
And if you don't have a smartphone, no worries. Some pieces have monitors mounted right next to them that will play short videos. And there will also be iPads scattered throughout the gallery that you're welcome to use too. The museum wants everyone to be able to join the conversation.
So by using the hashtag GlassApp, you'll be able to tweet or send Instagram pictures, but they'll also show up on monitors that we have mounted in the galleries, so you can see what other people's experience is like and how they're sharing their experience here in the new contemporary art wing.
Glass blowing was discovered about 2,000 years ago, and since then, it's been an art all about tradition. The Corning Museum of Glass is preserving that tradition, and their amphitheater hot shop directly pays homage to those glass-making roots. Leanne DeRosa has that story.
With glass blowing, a master teaches his apprentice. The apprentice learns, practices, and grasps the art, then becomes the master himself. It's a chain of tradition that's made its way to the southern tier in the mid-1800s, but is something that is still practiced here today.
For glassmaking in the valley here, really this is sacred ground. This is a space where art has been created, and people have stared in wonder at seeing its manufacture, and now we continue that tradition with our glassmaking demonstrations here on this site.
The Steuben Glass Factory opened in Corning in 1903. It moved from its original location on what is now Denison Parkway to this site in 1951, the same year the Corning Museum of Glass opened.
The Steuben Factory was on this site for more than 60 years, and we thought it was more than appropriate to bring glassmaking back into this space, into this historic structure.
The Steuben Glass Factory closed in 2011, but as part of the Kern expansion project, the museum wanted to keep its foundation and purpose intact, so they designed the Amphitheater Hot Shop.
The Amphitheater Hot Shop is located in the historic ventilator building that was once used for glassmaking for over three generations for the Steuben Glass Factory.
The museum preserved the original shape of the ventilator building, also known as the hot end of the factory, and took it back to its original 1950s steel structure.
And we really saw that as important historically, but also important architecturally, because it is a kind of fantastic industrial cathedral. And these were iconic structures that were built for glass factories, and they were designed to exhaust huge amounts of heat from a hot glass manufacturing facility.
With today's energy-efficient equipment, there's no need to add a working ventilator, but aesthetically, it replicates the look and feel of the old-fashioned factory.
We elected not to recreate that, largely because it would no longer have a function. And so, and instead of that particular component, we've inserted skylights.
The skylights and floor-to-ceiling windows flood the dark, industrial-looking room with natural light. But that's not all that lights the space.
The molten glass is the star of the show here. And that orange glow really becomes the center of attention when you strip everything else away.
Walking into the amphitheater, the glass is truly the center of attention. A 360-degree balcony lets you watch the show from above. Or the 500-seat retractable seating system allows you to get as close as you want to all the action.
You know, there's something about walking into a glass factory. The roar of the furnaces, the energy that you feel when you walk into those kinds of spaces. And visitors to the museum will have that kind of feeling coming into this space.
The Corning Museum of Glass boasts a world-class hot glass demo team. Ross DiMattei talked to them about the programs they'll host in this brand new venue.
Welcome to the brand new Amphitheater Hot Shop. It's the most capable glass-making demonstration space in the world. It can hold up to 500 guests. But what is a world-class amphitheater without world-class gaffers? That's where the Hot Glass Demo Team comes in. The team is made up of extremely talented gaffers who live and breathe glassblowing. They are led by Eric Meek, who has more than 20 years of glassblowing experience. He's now in charge of hot glass programming. Eric is excited about the endless possibilities for his hot glass team, thanks to their massive new amphitheater.
I'm really looking forward to the fact that we can make anything that we can dream, and that wasn't the case in the past. The equipment here, the way it's scaled, the capabilities of the equipment really allow us to make anything that we want, and that's not a possibility that we've had before.
More specifically, bigger and better equipment will allow the gaffers to create more impressive work than ever before.
We have larger equipment, we have more glass, we have the ability to melt different colors of glass, and then we have larger ovens to cool the glass down, so that will all enable us to make bigger work and more complicated work.
The new amphitheater will be mainly used for more special demonstrations and in-depth programs. Maybe the most exciting new program is the guest artist program, which is only possible because of the new amphitheater.
During the summer season, we have hundreds or even thousands of guests a day, so we needed a larger venue to accommodate all of those guests. What we're excited about also is that in the shoulder seasons and in the off season, we'll have the ability to invite guest artists in, artists who work with glass and maybe artists who have never worked with glass before, to come in here and experiment and do that in front of the public.
The museum will invite some of the best artists from around the world to create and perform side by side with the Hot Glass Demo Team. Eric says it doesn't really matter if those artists have a background in glass or not.
For a glass museum, it's always important to invite the royalty of glass artists. So there are a lot of contemporary glass artists that we're going to invite here. Lino Tagliapietra is certainly the first artist that we'll have it here, and he's one of the most famous glass artists working in the world today. But outside of that, we also want to invite artists who work in the fine art world. For example, we'll be working with the Ladd Brothers, who are fine artists from New York City, who haven't really worked with glass a lot before, but they're going to come here and work with our glass makers to create their art.
Eric Meek says what really matters is the gaffers have the opportunity to collaborate with some of the best artists to make great work for the community to enjoy.
First of all, I think that this new amphitheater will give the community a chance to really realize that the Corning Museum of Glass is the world center for glass making. They'll be able to come here and see the most famous artists in the world working in glass, and for the community, that's just an amazing opportunity. Also, this will be a great party venue, so we have our famous 2300s. The 2300 in this space will be a whole new thing. It's a great space. We'll be able to have music in here and live glass making, and I think the community will love that.
In the first month after the Amphitheater Hot Shop opens, the museum will host three world-class artists in association with its guest artist program. The Hot Glass Demo Team will be working with world-renowned glass artist Lino Tagliapietro, also a famous metal sculptor named Albert Paley, and Bertil Wallin, who is a prominent glass caster from Sweden. The amphitheater will heat up Saturday night when the Ladd Brothers come to town for 2,300 degrees.
Founded in 1951 by Corning Glassworks, now Corning Incorporated, the Corning Museum of Glass was a gift to the nation to celebrate the company's 100th anniversary. Fast forward to today, the Corning Museum of Glass is a landmark location for the city of Corning and surrounding communities. Logan Wilson has a look at the impact on the community.
The Corning Museum of Glass attracts over 440,000 visitors a year, which is a lot for a town with a population of 11,000 people.
The Corning Museum of Glass has always been a critical part of the tourism experience here, but also a major component of what people from within the region enjoy about our city.
In 1951, Corning Incorporated founded the Corning Museum of Glass as a gift to the nation in celebration of its 100th anniversary. The museum was created as its own non-for-profit, but the company has generously supported the museum for the last 64 years.
And we've seen this keep on going, that level of support keep on going for the last 64 years, and it's just been phenomenal, the amount of support that we get from Corning Incorporated.
Corning Incorporated fully funded the new contemporary art and design wing, graciously contributing $64 million to the new expansion.
So I think a key part of this for Corning Incorporated is to help to give back to the community. And in fact, one of the things that they ask us to do is to make sure that we really are helping to strengthen the economy of the community and helping to bring more people into this area to help out with all the aspects of the local area.
The museum's mission statement is to tell the world about glass by engaging, educating, and inspiring visitors in the community through the art, history, and science of glass. The new expansion engages both the community and time by linking three generations of international tourists to the region.
It's a nice thing that they're adding the contemporary wing because it just enhances an experience that is already so fantastic that for generations people have been enjoying it.
Currently, visitors spend an average of 4 to 5 hours in the museum. The museum anticipates longer visits, which they hope translates into more tourism in the community.
Not only helps the business financially, but it puts Corning on the map because the museum is a world-renowned museum.
The museum is celebrating the expansion and the community with free events on opening weekend.
Go and understand that they can go see the wineries, they can go shopping in Market Street, they can go visit the local communities, they can participate in many, many other activities here, making not just the museum a destination area, but the region in general a destination area.
Now we've given you an in-depth look of the Contemporary Art and Design Wing here at the Corning Museum of Glass, from the collection to the installation, the architecture of the building itself. But Carol, for people who come here opening weekend, what can they expect?
Well, we are thrilled to be sharing this new facility with our friends and family here in the Crystal City. So when visitors come, we have free admission all weekend long. And on Saturday night from 6 to 9, we have a very special 2300 degrees, our sort of community open house that everyone has come to love. We have the Ladd Brothers doing a special design performance as part of that 2300. We have three different musical guests who will be performing throughout the facility. We will have family activities, scavenger hunts, and things like that. So there's a lot to do. There's obviously a lot to see, and we are very excited about sharing this.
All right, and so we want to thank you for telling us about the museum, the expansion. We want to thank you for joining us. So on behalf of the Corning Museum of Glass and WENY-TV, we want to invite you to come out to experience the museum and the Contemporary Art and Design Wing for yourself. Carol, anything else you'd like to add?
Thank you for coming. We're thrilled to be able to share it with you.
All right, thank you.